Hello everyone. Narcissist Free almost here, and this week's topic is a continuation of the last video where I talked about hatred, namely envy. And what this looks like is fear of the object's potential destructiveness, and where this comes from is actually from the person's past and projection of their own rage. Today I'll be going into self-hatred, transference, the Cartman drama triangle, and link to the hated object. In these personality disorders, specifically malignant narcissism, there is a tendency towards self-mutilation and non-depressive suicidal behaviors, where self-mutilation typically reflects unconscious identification with the hateful and hated object. Hatred and inability to tolerate communication with the object may protect the person from what may otherwise emerge as a combination of cruel attacks on the object, paranoid fears of the object, and self-directed aggression in identification with the object. In other words, consider yourself lucky when the narcissist isn't talking to you. You know how they love to punish you by ignoring you? Well, here's a new way to look at that little game, in that they're actually sparing you from their wrath and paranoia. Recall the paranoid projection they do so well? What's really happening is intense self-hatred, because of their deep-seated envy of you, as well as their fears that you will do to them what they're doing to you. Truly at the bottom of it all, this is them showing you what cowards they are. Furthermore, what this will look like in a clinical setting is that the transference will be characterized by arrogance, curiosity, and pseudo-stupidity, which is an incapacity to reflect on what the therapist says, and this illustrates the patient's acting out of envy with the destruction of meaning and sadism. If that's the case in a therapeutic setting, what would it look like if the narcissist is a significant other? They, of course, would have them playing dumb when trying to talk to them, along with forgetting as manipulation, stonewalling as destruction of meaning, and given the chance to sabotage you, that would be an obvious acting out of sadism. One of the most consistent features in transferences dominated by acting out deep hatred is the person's extraordinary dependence on the therapist, manifested simultaneously with aggression toward the therapist, in what Kernberg calls an impressive demonstration of fixation to the trauma. What we do know, and most here have experienced this to the extreme, is the narcissist's need to be in control of everything, including and especially the narrative. And remember where this control originates? Recall the depressive position in infancy, and the use of manic defenses, where instead of choosing reparation by feeling their ambivalence, the infant chooses destruction to maintain omnipotent control of the object. The very essence of this use of control is a way of denying dependence on the object. Control, when you look at it for what it really is a way of compelling the object to meet dependency needs. In that respect, the more control used over an object, the more the controller is saying, "Take care of me." So, back to the clinical setting where at the same time the narcissist's fantasies and fears reflect his assumption that unless he consistently fights off the therapist, he will be subjected to a similar onslaught of hatred and sadistic exploitation and persecution from the therapist. Keep in mind this translates to intimate relationships of any kind. I know I went through this all the time with NARC too. The more you try, the harder they fight against you, leaving you baffled why the hell they got married in the first place. As you can already see, by means of projective identification, the narcissist is attributing his own hatred and sadism onto the therapist. Also notice that this situation illustrates the link between persecutor and persecuted, master and slave, sadist and masochist, all referring in the last resort to the sadistic, frustrating, teasing mother and paralyzed infant. The narcissist is enacting an object relation between persecutor and victim, alternating these roles in his identification, while projecting the reciprocal role onto the therapist. Here, I've put up the Cartman drama triangle so you can see how this plays out. You can also apply this to everyday real life, especially those you've identified as disordered, and it will be able to accurately predict their behavior. For example, NARC 2 could often play all three roles in a single day. I don't wonder anymore why I was so confused all the time. Anyway, one of his favorite sabotage games were getting me fired from my jobs, of course without me knowing it. He would do this by going along with me to a social function, playing the supportive husband role. There my boss would be and he would turn on the charm. I would walk away for a few minutes, and I kid you not, 5 minutes tops, and in this time, he could convince them to fire me by Monday morning. I was none the wiser in a moment, looking at both of them and their shit-eating grins, knowing what had just happened and what one of them was about to do. If this doesn't shake your faith in humanity, I don't know what does. My only guess is that he would tell them horrible things, and to this day I still have no idea what he could have said. By the way, by the second time this happened I tried talking to the former boss, and even some employees when I gave my 2 weeks' notice, and not one of them, like every other friend that was turned against me in the same way, would tell me anything. They either refused to talk to me, or barely said a word. To this day, he smeared the hell out of me, and I have no idea what he said. Amazing, isn't it? Yeah, he's that big of a con artist slime ball, who people think is a great guy. I'm telling you, he's his first kill away from being a serial killer, if he isn't already. Also, notice that in most of these pathological cases, it's as if the only alternative to being victimized is to become a tyrant, and the repeated succession of hatred and sadism would appear to be the only form of survival and meaning, aside from murder, suicide, and psychopathy. Recall the intrapsychic structures of the disordered personality according to James Masterson. Here, the borderline is unintegrated, perceiving things like the infant in the paranoid schizoid position. The narcissist, on the other hand, is fused with the primary object, where there is no boundary between self and object. It looks very different, but it isn't really. They both possess all of the same ego defects and primitive defense mechanisms, meaning they behave almost identical. Now, here is the psychopath. Again, you will see all the same behaviors, but the key difference is the complete detachment from the object. So, Kernberg is suggesting here, that in the highly disordered a solution, aside from murder or suicide, is psychopathy. What I take away from this, is that psychopathy is a choice. I would imagine it's an unconscious one, but a choice all the same. Kernberg also found, in milder cases, an additional dynamic factor, envy emerges. That would be described as intolerance of the good object who escapes from the savagery, and who is hated for willfully withholding, as the narcissist fantasizes, what would transform the object from a persecuting one into an ideal one. Here, the search for an ideal object, an ideal mother, lies behind the unending onslaught of hatred in the transference. In still milder cases, with more sophisticated and elaborated types of sadomasochistic behavior within an erotic personality organization, is the discovery potential for pleasure in pain, the temptation to experience pain as a precondition for experiencing pleasure, in the context of castration anxiety, unconscious guilt over Oedipal strivings, and as the ultimate transformation of passively experienced pain into an active compromise solution of the corresponding unconscious conflicts. All these dynamics may emerge intimately condensed and combined with differences in degree and proportion. What they have in common is the intense motivation to maintain a link with the hated object, a link that gratifies these various primitive transferences and is, in Kernberg's view, responsible for the powerful fixation to this traumatic relationship. In other words, the disordered personality strives to maintain a relationship with the hated object, which seems baffling until you understand they are satisfying infantile interactions with the object. The discourse might look like anywhere from baby talk to intense temper tantrums, and to the disordered person, this is comfortable, familiar, and gratifying. For example, I would observe Narc to slip into a childlike lisp when he was particularly full of supply. Another time, when his mother was dying from old age in her home, we all sat with her in her last moments. I watched as Narc 2 chose to sit on the floor with his legs crossed while the siblings were reminiscing, and he would repeatedly refer to his daddy while picking at something on the floor. I found this disturbing as I watched this 6'3", 230-pound man in his 50s behaving like a toddler. It wasn't contrived or part of his acting repertoire, it was a genuine transference, if you will. In summary, we talked about the narcissist's inability to communicate with a hated object due to their pathological envy, and also covered the Karpman drama triangle briefly. I also hope you can see how, out of the narcissist's pathological hatred springs sadomasochistic behavior, and if your narc was anything like mine, the onslaught of projected rage will never stop until you either get away for good, or die, as the narcissist more than likely fantasizes about. But even if you think you got away, beware, the narcissist's compulsion to make you suffer will never end due to their own envy that you had the nerve to get away. Do not underestimate the desire to maintain a link to the hated object, which of course is unconsciously the primary object, mother, or primary caregiver, that has been transferred to you if you are a significant other. As the substitute, they will do anything in their power to satisfy their hostile internal world that was set in motion during tender years of development. So, that's it for this week. If you found this content helpful, please subscribe, like, and comment with any questions or experiences you've might have had with a pathological narcissist. Also, you can follow me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover with a U. Wishing everyone good health and sanity during these trying times, and as always, all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know, I am.